morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship. Glad to have you here on the Sunday that we celebrate the baptism of our Lord. If you would stand as you're able, we're going to join in singing our songs of praise this morning, Sweet, Sweet Spirit, and How Majestic is Your Name.
Fast. Oh Lord, my Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Oh Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Oh Lord, we praise your name. Oh Lord, we magnify your name. Up is mighty God, O Lord God Almighty. Lord, O Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. O Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. O Lord, we praise your name. O Lord, by your name, Prince of Peace, mighty
seated.
Please join me in the call to worship in our bulletin. As the water of the Jordan symbolized cleansing and purity,
may the waters of God's forgiveness splash over us, cleansing us of our sin.
As the dove descended upon Christ as a symbol of the Spirit,
may the Holy Spirit lie upon us today, preparing us for service.
As the word of the Father assured his Son of love and support, please join in singing the hymn, Praise the Lord, the Almighty, number 139.
Please join me in praying. Help us, Lord, to remember that with every privilege, there is a responsibility, and with every opportunity, there is an obligation. May we never treat our baptism as a magical act that relieves us of responsibility. May we never stop thanking you for the greatest gift we have ever received. May we never stop looking for ways to express the new life within us. May we not only be blessed in receiving, but may we also be fulfilled in giving. May we be eager to serve as to be served. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Let us now share our joys and our concerns.
birthday is in 6 days.
It is, isn't it? Saturday? Is that when your birthday is?
Yes.
Saturday. Well, happy birthday, Eric.
Thank you.
You're welcome. And I think while we're talking about birthdays, I will say that we have one birthday today. Where's Larry at? Oh, there he is. Today's your birthday? Yes, happy birthday to Larry today. And Jesse's is the 15th, so Tuesday. Do we have any other birthdays? Larry and Jesse and Eric? Anyone else have a birthday this week? No? Okay, let's congratulate all those people then. Have a happy birthday. We have other joys or concerns. It's a joy that Marilyn's here, right, today? Good to see her. Welcome, Marilyn. Good to have you back. And I do want to welcome Kevin Gowdy. He is here on this side. He is Executive Director of the Iowa United Methodist Foundation, and he's with us today. So welcome. We're glad you're with us. Other joys or concerns? I have been asked to have prayers for Joan Reichart, grandmother of Corey and Erica Reichart. So if you'll keep her in your prayers. Just a reminder, next Sunday, the 20th, Ed Kyle from the district office will be preaching, and I talked to him on Friday, and he's going to kind of have a combination of music and word for the service. I think it will really be exciting, so I hope you can come. That's just next Sunday. Following the worship service, we will go down to Fellowship Hall for a potluck supper, or dinner, excuse me, to honor Gordon and his 36-plus years as being a custodian here. And after that, after the meal, we're going to have a time of visioning for the church that Ed will lead us in. And he said that he thought that time would maybe be an hour and a half. So the whole day probably will be done around 2 o'clock. So we just hope you can come for worship in the morning and just share that morning and afternoon with us. One other thing, we have decided that we're able to offer the Dave Ramsey Financial Peace University classes again as we did last year. They have been condensed to 9 weeks. I believe last year they were 13 weeks. So our plan right now is to start on February 18th on a Monday evening for 9 weeks. So if you're interested, let us know. We do have kind of limited numbers of people that we will have for this time. So if you're interested, call the church office. Any other joys or concerns? Okay. Thank you, Andrew. Let us bow our heads then for a time of silent prayer. Dear gracious God, we come before you with praise and thanksgiving. We thank you for the privilege to be able to come to your house to worship together as the body of Christ. God, we thank you for everyone gathered here today. God, we are just so blessed to be able to be here together to worship you. Help us during this time of worship to be open to what you would have to teach us, God, what your desire is for our lives. We want to follow you, God, but we acknowledge that it is not always easy to do. There seem to be so many distractions that keep us from focusing on you. The pull of things of this world seems to be so strong and tempting at times. Teach us that true joy will come from following you and growing in our devotion to you. May that be so for us all, God. This morning we want to lift up prayers for Joan. God be with her and her family. We pray for healing for Doc, Kent, Barb, Rita, Nancy, Sandy, and Eileen, and Cole's father. We lift up all our soldiers to you and their families, God. Those folks that aren't able to be with us here today, whether they're traveling or not feeling well or homebound, God, or in the nursing home, we lift them up to you today, too. We continue to pray for the families at Newtown, God. We thank you, God, for the way you bless us each and every day, your constant presence with us on our good days and our bad days, God. We are so blessed to know that your love for us is the greatest love there is, God, and that that love will never end. We praise you today, God, for all that you bless us with. Lift all these prayers up and pray in your son's name. Amen. Please join me in praying the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Will sing, "We Are the Hands of Christ."
Speak his kindness, no eyes to see the pain.
A heart
Thank you, choir, and thank you, Merlin, for leading. We really appreciate it. I must say that if I had to pick a perfect song to go with my message for today, that would have been the one, and we didn't plan that, so thank you for the beautiful words today. It is time for our children's message. How are you today?
Good.
Good. Good, good, good. Good morning. How's everybody today? Are you good? It's good to see you as always. Well, I have a picture to show you from our Young Readers Bible. And that's what we're talking about today at church. Do you see that man in the water? Well, there are two men in the water. One is Jesus, and the other one is a man named, right, good, John the Baptist, right? And Jesus is being baptized, and that's what we're talking about today. After Jesus was baptized, then he began doing kind of his work, going around and teaching people and healing people and loving people and being kind and compassionate after he was baptized. Do you know what? When Jesus walked on the earth, people watched him, watched what he did and how he talked and how he treated people, and they learned a little bit more about God by watching Jesus. They learned more about God by watching Jesus. So now I have a question for you. Where's Jesus now? Do you see him walking around here?
No.
No. Have any of you seen Jesus walking around? No, I'm getting pretty old and I've never seen him. So how do we, besides reading the Bible and coming to Sunday school, how do we learn about what Jesus, who Jesus is like?
Reading the Bible and going to church and stuff.
Reading the Bible and going to church. And you know, there's another way. Do you know what it is? By looking at those people out there that are Christians, we learn who Jesus is like. Did you know that?
No.
Yes. And by looking at each other, you all believe in Jesus and love Jesus, right? So when you look at each other and how you act, that helps us learn how Jesus is. But we have to think about that. So I've got some pictures to show you, okay? And then I'll let you take one with you. All right, I'll try to hold them up so you can see. Okay, so here they're playing on the playground, okay? What do you think would be a better way to act so we could learn about Jesus? Is it good to, like, fight all the time, or is it good to try to get along?
Good to try to get along.
Try to get along. It's not always easy. Do you think they'd see Jesus in us better if we tried to get along?
No.
Probably they would, right? Do you think Jesus fought all the time with everybody?
No.
No. Okay, this is something I want to show you. Can you tell what this boy's doing? He's sharing his food with everybody. Do you think when we share food, people might see Jesus in us?
Yes.
Do you think they might say, I wonder if Jesus is like that, sharing?
Yeah.
Because Jesus does share. So then we see a little bit more about Jesus in us. Oh, I want to show you this one. This is a really neat picture. Okay, how about if I hold it all up and you can sit down and I'll hold it up high so you can see. Do you see what happened in this picture?
No.
A little girl got an ice cream cone and it fell off. Has that ever happened to you? It's happened to me before. I remember it happening. In Atlantic, I got an ice cream cone. As soon as I walked out of the store, the top fell off. So that little boy, do you see what he's doing? Right, he's given his ice cream cone. How kind is that, right? Do you think when we do those kind of things, people look at us and they say, they're a Christian. They love Jesus. That must be who Jesus is like. Do you think so? Yeah? Okay, I have one other one to show you. All right, you can kind of see this, what's going on here. This is a child. They're shopping in the store, okay? There are two children there. Which one, just look at the picture and tell me, which one do you think we would see Jesus in better? Which one of those two people? Can you tell what they're doing? Yeah, that one. She's just kind of shopping. What's the other one doing?
Fighting.
And
talking back.
He's talking back. He looks kind of upset, right? I think he's probably not getting what he wanted. Do you see there? He didn't see it? Okay, we'll show him. He's not actually very happy, is he? He's kind of yelling because he didn't get what he wanted. Okay, so and I've got more pictures, but I'll just give you some to take home. What I want you to think about, and you're young yet, so it's kind of hard, and you'll get better at it as you get older, but when we say we love Jesus, then people around us that don't know Jesus, they're looking at us, and they kind of want to see how we act and how we love each other, and then they learn a little bit more about Jesus. So do you think you could teach people about Jesus?
Yes.
I bet you can. I have a lot of faith in you that by the way you love people, that they'll see Jesus in you, and they'll learn more about Jesus because of you. Thank you for listening today. Can we say a prayer? Will you pray after me? Dear God, thank you for loving us. Help us to be more like you. Amen. Okay, do you want to take a sheet with you? You can take one of these. They're all different ones, okay, if you want to color one. Okay, there you go. Do you want one, Eric? Okay, you don't have to take one. There you go. There you go, honey. Thank you. You're welcome.
Our scripture lesson today is from Isaiah 43, 1 through 7, and in your pew Bible, it is page number 851. Israel, the Lord who created you says, "Do not be afraid, I will save you. I have called you by name, you are mine. When you pass through deep waters, I will be with you. Your troubles will not overwhelm you. When you pass through fire, you will not be burned. The hard trials that come will not hurt you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy God of Israel, who saves you. I will give up Egypt to set you free. I will give up Sudan and Suba. I will give up whole nations to save your life, because you are precious to me. And because I love you and give you honor, do not be afraid. I am with you. From the distant east and the farthest west, I will bring your people home. I will tell the north to let you go and the south not to hold them back. Let my people return from distant lands, from every part of the world. They are my own people, and I created them to bring me glory."
Please stand as you're able for the sharing of the gospel lesson this morning from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 3, verses 15, 16, and 17, and 21 and 22. People's hopes began to rise, and they began to wonder whether John perhaps might be the Messiah. So John said to them, "I baptize you with water, but someone is coming who is much greater than I am. I am not good enough even to untie his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. He has his winnowing shovel with him to thresh out all the grain and gather the wheat into his barn, but he will burn the chaff in a fire that never goes out." After all the people had been baptized, Jesus also was baptized. While he was praying, heaven was opened, and the Holy Spirit came down upon him in a bodily form like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my own dear son. I am pleased with you." This is God's good news. While you are standing, as you're able, we're going to sing "When Jesus Came to Jordan," and I think Sharon and Merlin are kind enough to lead us in that. I'm not sure. It might be kind of new to you, a little different tune, but it is part of what we're celebrating today, the message in that song. So they will help us sing it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Please be seated. Thank you, Marlon and Sharon. When I taught school in Anita, it had been quite a few years ago now, it was the tradition of that school for all fifth grade classes to take a field trip to Des Moines, to the Capitol. And I remember several conversations with my fifth grade class before we actually went on that field trip. The conversations were about my expectations for them with regard to their behavior while on that field trip. I told them that they represented the Anita Elementary School, and while the people that they would come in contact at the Capitol with, such as the greeters and the guides, would not know them by name, they would know that they were from the Anita Elementary School. I told them, you need to behave in such a way that when you leave, the people that you have come in contact with have a favorable impression of the Anita Elementary School. I borrowed the words for the title of my message today from the United Methodist Hymnal. You could look it up right now on page 34. The words "Christ's representatives in the world" are written on that page. They are part of our baptismal covenant. Candidates for baptism are asked the following question: according to the grace given to you, will you remain faithful members of Christ's holy church and serve as Christ's representatives in the world? And of course, the candidates always answer, I will. Reminds me really of the service of Christian marriage in the United Methodist Book of Worship. The couples are asked the following question: will you love, comfort, honor, and keep in sickness and health, forsaking all others, be faithful as long as you both shall live? And of course, they always answer, I will. To be honest, if you really thought about that, right? If you said, well, let me think about that, you might have second thoughts. And seriously, if you thought about the question, will you serve as Christ's representatives in the world, we might have second thoughts as well. Maybe we could pull off being Christ's representatives in the church, you know, this hour of worship. But in the world, that means we have promised to serve as Christ's representatives in our workplace, in our homes, in our business dealings. We don't get weekends off or holidays. It is a 24/7 commitment. That's a pretty high calling. Previously, I said I borrowed the title of my sermon from the Baptismal Covenant Liturgy. And to be honest, the writer of the Baptismal Covenant borrowed the words as well. The idea that baptized persons are to serve as Christ's representatives in the world is scriptural. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21 reads, were Christ representatives. Different Bible translations word that a little differently. Some say we are ambassadors for Christ. If you look it up in our Pew Bibles, the words will say, here we are then speaking for Christ. But regardless of the words used, whether representatives or ambassadors or speaking for Christ, the message is the same. The question for today is, what does it mean to be an ambassador, a representative for Jesus Christ in the year 2013 in our community of Oakland, Iowa, and beyond? Well, I thought about that, and I thought, for sure it has to have something to do with love, right? You just can't get away from that. God is love. Jesus is love. Surely Christ's representatives in the world are love. The problem is people have varying ideas of what love is. So we really need to get a biblical perspective on love. And what better chapter than the 13th chapter of 1 Corinthians that is lovingly referred to as the love chapter. Those are the verses that oftentimes you hear at a Christian marriage service. Sometimes, though, people skip over the first part of this chapter and go right into the verses that actually describe what love is. But I think when that happens, it's very unfortunate because the first three verses of this chapter are as significant as the rest of the chapter. I want to read those first three verses to you. I may be able to speak the language of men and even of angels, but if I have no love, my speech is no more than a noisy gong or a clanging bell. I may have the gift of inspired preaching. I may have all knowledge and understand all secrets. I may have all faith needed to move mountains, but if I have no love, I am nothing. I may give away everything I have and even give up my body to be burned, but if I have no love, this does me no good. Now, wouldn't you think that being a brilliant speaker or having an IQ of a genius or having a powerful faith or being generous with what you've been given or being willing to make sacrifices should count for something? You would think. Yet we are told if love is not the motivational factor behind what you do or have accomplished, then it does you no good. When I got my very first appointment to serve as a pastor, I had not attended any schools of theology. I had never served communion by myself. I had never baptized anyone. I had preached a total of three sermons, maybe two. I can't remember for sure now. So it's an understatement to say there was a lot I did not know. But God blessed me with a very kind, understanding mentor. And he was a retired pastor, and he seemed to understand my concerns. And when I say concerns, I'm putting that lightly. I was just over the top with anxiety. I was having trouble sleeping. I was scared. I just didn't know what to expect. I didn't know what I was doing, to be honest. This retired pastor gave me some very, very wise advice, which helped calm my fears. He simply said, just love them and you'll be okay. He knew what the author of the love chapter was saying. It won't matter if you can preach like Billy Graham or know the Bible better than the winners on the TV show American Bible Challenge, hosted by comedian Jeff Foxworthy, if you've seen that show, if you don't love your people. So how are we to love so we will be able to best represent our Lord and Savior? The scriptures tell us that love is patient and love is kind. You know, I thought about that every day, we all have the opportunity to represent Christ with this kind of love. When we have to wait longer than we think we should in a grocery line, or have to wait on a new employee as they learn to check us out, we can choose to respond with patience and kindness, or we can choose to react with anger, frustration, or maybe even worse. The scriptures say love is not conceited or proud. Again, we always have the opportunity to treat the people we encounter on a daily basis as our equals. Loving people means we don't think we are better than anyone else because we have more money or more education or maybe we think even more morals. Love is not selfish. Again, every day we have the opportunity to represent Christ by giving of ourselves. Some days we do that in a big way, like maybe volunteering to spend a week helping clean up after a flood. But we also can love unselfishly in smaller ways, like taking time out of our busy days to call a friend who's having a rough time or maybe visit someone who is homebound. The scriptures also teach us that love does not keep a record of wrongs. Reading about a Christian who says they have forgiven someone for some horrific crime against them or against a loved one, for me, is such an incredible witness to the love of God, because we know that's only possible through God's love. What a wonderful way to represent Jesus Christ. Most of us, I think, would probably admit that forgiving is not always easy. Sometimes it is very, very hard to do. And some actions would seem to be humanly impossible to forgive. Just this past week, I watched a video online of Katie Couric, and I'm not sure when she had this interview, but she was interviewing a couple whose daughter was one of the victims of the Newtown shooting. It was heartbreaking to watch, but I was amazed at the words this couple shared with regard to the shooter. The husband expressed no feelings of anger, only feelings of sadness for a man who he described as struggling with something very dark. And then the mother said she was blessed by her Heavenly Father because anger wasn't an emotion she was dealing with. She too expressed sadness for a man who she said must have been in an unimaginable state of mind, in a dark and evil place to be able to do what he did. What incredible representatives of Christ are this mother and father. Love is not happy with evil, but is happy with the truth, the scriptures tell us. If the social principles of the United Methodist Church needed a slogan, that verse from the love chapter would be the one I would suggest. Love is not happy with evil, but is happy with the truth. As Christians, we represent Christ when we speak out and act to alleviate the evils of our world today, such as human trafficking, hunger, preventable diseases like malaria, violence, prejudices, a lack of clean water, and medical care for all people. And while we may not always agree on our ways to solve those social evils, we are required by God to care and to do our part in seeking justice for all people. We are told that love never gives up. Being Christ's representatives in the world means we continue to hope even when those around us are giving up. This is a beautiful verse about hope from 1 Peter. Praise be to God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. We know the end of the story. We know that one day God will reign over all the world and justice will prevail. There will be no more hunger or war or disease or death. And until that time, we can confidently put our hope in our Lord and Savior to guide us through this life and never leave us. I want to just share again what Kathy shared with you from Isaiah. It's such a beautiful passage, words of hope. I'll just share a little bit of it. Listen to these again. Do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. The truth is, we are a people of hope, hope that is to be shared with other people. And finally, the love chapter tells us that love is eternal. Love never ends. As Christ's representatives in the world, we are called to keep loving. There will never come a time in our earthly lives when we will be able to say, I have loved enough, I am done. It is a lifetime calling. And while it can be hard to serve as Christ's loving representatives in the world, the good news is it is not as hard as it sounds. Because as a baptized children of God, we have the Spirit of God living within us to help us love as Christ loves. Maybe the hardest part is wanting to. God certainly will not force any of us to love. It is a choice we make. In fact, it is a daily choice we make. Every day we choose whether we want to serve as Christ's representative or whether we want to serve ourselves. Personally, I know there have been days I have chosen the latter. I'm sure if Jerry was here, he would testify to that. It seems that sometimes the people we love most were the most, I don't know how to put this, sometimes unchristlike. Do you know what I mean? And I think that's because we know those people are always going to love us, right? Even when we're not at our best, those people that we are the closest to, we have that assurance that they're going to forgive us and keep loving us, even though our actions sometimes are not lovable. Well, the same is true for God. He's going to keep loving us even when our actions aren't always lovable. We are not perfect people. I don't know of anyone on this earth who loves perfectly. But hopefully as we grow in our faith and more in love with our Lord, the days we serve as Christ's representatives in the world will outnumber the days that we don't. I'm going to share a suggestion with you. I'm going to share a suggestion with you that I read about in an article entitled I Represent Christ, written by Richard Holland. Mr. Holland suggests that tomorrow, when you awake, before you leave the house or interact with your family, that you pin an imaginary button on yourself that says, I represent Christ. Imagine that everywhere you go, people will read the button. Do you think you might do anything differently during your day, at home, at work, at school? Today, when you came to worship, you received a pretend pin with the words, I represent Christ, that honestly, I almost forgot to give you. Some of you got in here, so if I didn't hand you one, I've got more that I can give you. My suggestion is that, myself included, that we place that pretend pin in a prominent place in our home or at work, wherever you need most to be reminded that you are, in fact, a representative of Jesus Christ. In ending, I have a story to share with you about a man named Bill, and this is kind of an old story, so you might have heard it before, but I think it is a good story to hear. His name is Bill. He has wild hair, wears a t-shirt with holes in it, jeans and no shoes. This was literally his wardrobe for his entire 4 years of college. He's brilliant, kind of eccentric. He became a Christian recently while attending college. Across the street from the campus is a well-dressed, very conservative church. One day, Bill decides to go there. He walks in with no shoes, jeans, his t-shirt, and wild hair. The service has already started, and so Bill starts down the aisle looking for a seat. The church is completely packed, and he can't find a seat. By now, people are really looking a bit uncomfortable, but no one says anything. Bill gets closer and closer to the pulpit, and when he realizes there are no seats, he just squats down kind of right in front there on the carpet. By now, the people are really uptight, and the tension in the air is thick. About this time, the minister realizes that from way at the back of the church, an elder is slowly making his way toward Bill. Now, this man is in his 80s, has silver gray hair in a three-piece suit. A godly man, very elegant, very dignified, very courtly. He walks with a cane, and as he starts walking toward this boy, everyone is saying to himself, but you can't blame him for what he's going to do. How can you expect a man of his age and of his background to understand some college kids sitting on the floor? It takes a long time for the man to reach the boy. The church is utterly silent except for the clicking of the man's cane. All eyes are focused on him. You can't even hear anyone breathing. The minister can't even preach the sermon until the elder does what he has to do. And now they see this elderly man drop his cane on the floor. With great difficulty, he lowers himself and sits down next to Bill and worships with him so he won't be alone. Everyone chokes up with emotion. When the minister gains control, he says, "What I'm about to preach, you will never remember. What you have seen, you will never forget. Be careful how you live. You are Christ's representatives in the world." And all God's children said, Amen. I would ask our ushers to come forward now to take our offering.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Gracious God, realizing that our baptism is for service as well as for salvation, for commitment as well as for cleansing, we present these gifts as evidence that we take seriously the meaning of the sacrament in our lives. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. The hymn we are going to sing now, We Are Called. There is an insert in your bulletin if you want to read the music, and it will be on the screen as well, and Merlin has graciously agreed to lead us in that. I think we have sung it once or twice, but it is still fairly new to us.
To try and lead. Try, the operative word.
Thank you for joining us for worship today. We invite you to stay for a time of refreshments. Go in peace. May the love of God, the grace of Jesus Christ, and the power of the Holy Spirit be with you this day and remain with you for always. Amen.